Praise the Lord, everyone. If we could all stand this morning. Good to be in the house of the Lord today. Why don't you look at your neighbor and give him a high five? Wake him up a little bit. Yeah, get the smile on their face. Let them know that the joy of the Lord is here. All right, now give them a handshake and tell them you're so sorry for hitting their hand so hard. It's good when we can be gathered together with our brothers and our sisters, and we love to stand beside each other, because we know that if I'm going through something, guess what? I know they're going to have my back. They're going to pray for me. They're going to be standing beside me, filling in the gap. So good to be in I feel so good to be in a church that loves each other. Because God is love, right? Let's lift our hands all over this house right now and just invite him into this place. Jesus, we love you, Lord. We thank you for what you're doing in this house. We thank you for what you're going to do in this place today, Lord. We ask right now in Jesus' name that you would touch today. Lord, let your Holy Ghost fall. We ask right now that your presence, Lord, would just fill this place today. We want more of you, Jesus, and less of us today. Lord, we want to leave changed in the way that we came in, Lord. We didn't come here, Lord, just to play games. We came, oh God, to get a hold of you today, Lord. We ask right now in the name of Jesus, you would anoint pastors as he speaks today. Anoint every teacher, every Sunday school student, Lord. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would just fall in this house today. Lord, we want you, Jesus. We want you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Why don't we just lift our hands right now and just tell him how much we love him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. Oh, yes. And you are the source of life, and I can't be left behind, and no one else will do. And I will take hold of you, and my heart is yours, oh, for life, I need your hand in mine, no one else will do. Oh Lord, and I put my trust in you, 'cause I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue. And where can I go? There's no other name by which I am saved. Capture me with grace. I will follow you. Oh, yes, I will follow you. My heart is yours, for life I need your hand in mine, no one else will do. Yes, Lord, and I put my trust in you, 'cause I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue.
Where else can I go?
There's no other name by which I am saved. Oh, capture me with grace, 'cause I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue. Follow you. Oh yes, I'm gonna follow. I will follow you. Oh yes, I will. I
will follow you.
Oh, I made the choice.
I will follow you. This world has nothing for me.
I will follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
I will follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
I will follow you.
If this world has nothing for me, 'cause I need you, Jesus, to come to my rescue.
Yes, I will follow.
I will follow you.
Oh, I will follow you.
I will follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
I will follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
I will follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
Jesus, to come to my rescue. Yes, where else can I go?
There's no other name by which I am saved.
Oh yes, capture me.
Just one more time. This house, when we just raise our hands and love Jesus all over this place. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. We love you, Lord. We praise your name, God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. How many can admit this morning that you need Jesus? I need Jesus. Every day that I live, I need the Lord today. If you have your Bibles this morning, if you turn with me to the book of Genesis, chapter number 32. Today I am glad to be in the house of God today. I am honored that the Lord has chosen us to be in His presence, and never want to take it lightly what God is doing. Never want to take it lightly, and just not for the miracles, and I thank God for that as well, but I thank God for the things that we probably forget about, you know, the air that we breathe, the strength that we have, the blessings of God that come to us every day that sometimes we take for granted. And to live a thankful life is to have a blessed life, to have a blessed life. The book of Genesis, chapter number 32. Is Brother Ramon in here? Brother Ramon. He's getting some chairs out. He's coming up. I want him to come up here. He's going to testify. Before I preach, he's going to testify. He's got a great testimony that I think. How many's been noticing what God's been doing around here? Been performing some miracles? Amen today. Amen. Hear this testimony.
Well, I've been going to the doctor for a while. I'd had some prostate problems, and they've been doing blood work on me, and it seemed like every time they do the blood work, it just kept going higher and higher. And the last time I went was on the 17th, and the number was 24. And he says, "I believe you got cancer." He says, "I want to do a biopsy." So they did a biopsy on me, and that was on a Friday. And that Sunday, I got prayed for, and I've been claiming my healing ever since. And so Monday, they sent me to Richmond for a nuclear test on my bones and also on my stomach, and hadn't heard nothing. And so Wednesday, I called the office, and the nurse said, "Well, we can't tell you anything over the phone," but she says, "I will tell you this. If he found anything bad, he'd have had you in here." And so I'm claiming my healing, that there's nothing there, that it's all gone. And I know he's gonna have a question wondering where it went, because he did the biopsy and it come back cancer, and then they couldn't find nothing. So I just give the Lord the praise and the glory for it, because you can't outdo our God. He's just a big God. And no matter how small the problem seems, you know, God still cares. And I just love him this morning, and just happy I'm here.
Amen. Amen. Let's give Jesus a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. Amen. And we're thankful for what God is doing. And again, we never want to take for granted what God is doing. Our God is real. Our God is real today. And I think that when we test Him, He shows up. He shows up. And we've been praying, and we've been seeking God, and God's been showing up. Genesis chapter number 32, verse number 22. It simply says, "And he rose up that night and took his two wives and his two woman servants and his 11 sons and passed over the ford Jabbok. And he took them and sent them over the brook and sent over that he had. And Jacob was left alone. And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that he had prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh. And the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him." He wrestled, he fought with him. "And he said, 'Let me go, for the day breaketh.' And he said, 'I will not let thee go,' as he wrestled with him. And he said, 'Let me go, for the day breaketh.' And he said, 'I will not let thee go, except thou bless me, except thou bless me.' And he said unto him, 'What is thy name?' He said, 'Jacob.' He said, 'Jacob.' And he said, 'Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed.' And Jacob asked him and said, 'Tell me, I pray thee, thy name.' And he said, 'Wherefore is it that thou dost ask for my name?' And he blessed him there, and he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of that place Peniel, 'For I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved.'" My life is preserved. A couple things I want to bring out today before we really get into what I believe the Lord has given me. But when this man, this angel asked asked Jacob. He said, first off, he said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And Jacob said the first time, he said, I will not let you go. I will not let you go. And then this man, this angel said a second time, let me go, for the day breaketh. The day breaketh. The second time, Jacob, he said, he started out the same way, but then ended differently. He said, I will not let you go until you bless me. The first time he said, I'm not going to let you go. The second time is, I will not let you go until you bless me. One scripture later, he got his blessing. And I think it's important to note today, it's not my notes, but I think in your prayer journals, and we're going to talk about this here in the next coming weeks, is when you pray, make sure you pray specifically for what you're really wanting God to do. Just don't put it out there, God, just bless me, bless me. Put it out there and ask God, Lord, I want you to bless me in this particular place in my life. Lord, I need to see a miracle for this and for that. Because if you're going to get what you pray for, you better ask specifically what you need for God to do in your life. The first time you didn't get blessed, because he said, I'm not going to let you go. The second time he got his blessing because he opened up his mouth and spoke specifically as to what he wanted. He said, Lord, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. And then he got his blessing. Today, I want to, I'm transitioning out of title of what the Bible say about healing, but we'll end up at the same place. On the title, I want to give us a new title today, simply entitled, Angels Among Us. Angels Among Us. Let's pray. Jesus, Lord, I love you today and I praise you, God. I give you glory and I give you honor today, Jesus. This morning, God, I thank you for your presence here already today, God. You are a great God, a merciful God, a saving God, a true God, a healing God. Oh, this morning, God, your presence has been with us already. And Lord, therefore, God, we are so blessed today, God. I pray that the word of the Lord would move in this place, God. Let the power of the living God flow in this room, Lord, I pray. God, you know every single need. You know what we battle in our lives. You know the battle of our minds. God, you know, God, the very need of our bodies, Lord. I pray today, God, Lord, that we, our faith, would be encouraged today and that the word of God would increase our faith, God, today. Lord, that we might leave and walk out of this place before the door closes with the answers that we have been praying for. I love you and I praise you and I give you glory. You are a real God and I believe in you. I believe in you, Lord Jesus. I pray it. Hallelujah. One more time. Could we love Jesus this morning all across this sanctuary? Our young people, our children are already in their classes, but could we just worship God this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh God, you're an awesome God. You are real. You are powerful, God. You are sovereign. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship, we praise you this morning, God. The name above all names, the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Jacob's story is quite interesting. It is a familiar story, but Jacob, his name literally meant the deceiver, who eventually becomes Israel, the prince. Jacob loved comfort. The Bible says he was a plain man. In Genesis 25, it says that he was plain and he dwelt in tents. He was essentially a man that was loved by his mama. If Jacob lived in today's society, we would inevitably call him a mama's boy. Because he just was. He was always close to mama. We know through the scriptures that he deceived Esau out of his birthright, the birthright, meaning the double portion blessing that God was fixing to pour out. Esau thought this birthright was useless without the blessing of God, and therefore it was not important to him to sell it off for a pottage or a portage of just a meal. With the help of his mother Rebekah, Jacob deceived, he deceived Isaac, and it's just a fascinating story in his life. But he deceived Isaac into giving him the blessing with the help of his mama. He fled Esau's wrath, and he saw a vision, that vision of Jacob's ladder. He saw that vision at Bethel. Bethel meaning the house of God, meaning the house of God. We later learn that the name was transferred in one application as not Bethel, but El Bethel, meaning God's house, the God of his house. And this was important after 20 years of God's blessings. The Bible says that he meets up with an angel in the worst crisis of his life, facing Esau again and living in a life of fear. For 20 years of being tormented in the mind, for 20 years of running from your life, of 20 years of running from tent to tent, from country to country, for 20 years not knowing if you was going to live to see another day, for 20 years just wondering and hearing noises in the nighttime, thinking that Esau's finally found me, Esau's going to come and get me, for 20 years of fear, for 20 years of running and wishing and hoping and dreaming that this moment would pass by. There is a one moment right now in his life, this one moment of fear, that he's in a place, a country called Peniel. And at that moment in his life could possibly be changed. But he's going to have to come face to face with his fears and face to face with the God that can work anything out. And we must understand, for 20 long years, he's gone through a battle of the mind. For 20 long years, how many sleepless nights has he had? For 20 long years, how many times has he wondered, could tonight be my last night? Could tonight be the night that everything ends? Could maybe God's punishing me for what I did when I was younger. Maybe tonight's gonna, you see, the lot of times the miracle that we need will not be in our flesh, but the miracle that we need will be in our members. They're gonna be in our brain. Because the greatest battle that you'll ever face will not be on the other end of a doctor's report, but the greatest and most consistent battle that all of us will face will be the battle between our ears, the battle of the mind, the battle if, well, God, am I coming or am I going? Is the devil fighting? Am I going to make it or am I not going to make it? For 20 years, he's gone through a battle, and God moves in his life, and now could be the breaking moment in his whole life. For 20 years, could today in Peniel be the day that everything changes? I will tell you today in this place that you have to get a made up mind sometimes to understand that today could be my moment. Right now could be my time. For those out there that have just you've thrown in the white towel, or you've thrown in the surrender and said, well, I've lived it for 20 years, why not 21? I've lived it for this long, why not just a little bit longer? Can I tell you, I believe sometimes we don't pray right, because we've learned to live with suffering. We've learned to live with less. And I preached a message years ago that we essentially have a generation that has learned to love living off of a quarter of a tank. We've learned to love on empty. And I know that God can bless you with just a crumb that falls from the master's table. But that's a today blessing. But a crumb won't feed you tomorrow, and it won't feed you the day after that. You've got to learn to pick up a loaf and say to yourself, I'm going to get everything that God has for my life. Unfortunately, you'll never pray for healing if you've learned to accept defeat. I've known so many people that have learned to live with fear, and God's trying to break it from you, and God's trying to release you from it. I know so many pastors that's fallen in love with just a little bit, so they don't try to win anybody else because they feel like, well, I can control what I've got. Can I tell you right now, it was never meant for us to control the move of God, but it's always meant for God to control the move of us. And if we're not careful, we'll fall in love with defeat. We'll fall in love with losing. We'll fall in love with being lost. We'll fall in love with being a victim. We'll fall in love with less. When God's trying to give us the abundance of our heart, he's trying to give us what we're asking for, but you won't pray for anything that you've learned to accept. And if you want to have a victorious life, you got to learn how to pray. I'm not just talking about putting your 5 minutes every morning and every night. I'm talking about you got to learn how to pray, because you will never take over territories that you don't pray for and that you don't say, God, this is mine. But if you quit praying, God, I want this back in my life. God, I need my mind back. God, I need my joy back. God, I need my happiness back. God, I need that peace that passes all under. If you quit praying, God won't send it. And that's why Jacob said, I'm not going to let go until you bless me. What he was really saying was this: I'm tired of going to bed in fear. I'm tired of waking up in the middle of the night. I'm tired of the mind battles. I'm tired of this battle in my mind. God, I'm not letting you go until you bless me. I'm not letting you go until you heal me. And you will never be free until you learn to fight for what you want. You'll never be free until you learn to fight for what you want. I'm not talking about bombs and guns. I'm not talking about fists and elbows. I'm not talking about in the wrestling ring. I'm talking about when you get into your prayer closet and you say to God, I don't care what's on the agenda. If I got to pray 2 hours, I'll pray 2 hours. If I got to be in here 3 hours locked up, I'm going to be in here 3 hours. But I'm not going to quit until I get my blessing. I'm not going to quit until I get my breakthrough. And Jacob learns the valuable lesson. He said, I'm in Peniel. I'm here with an angel. I'm not going to let go because I don't know when I'm going to get this next opportunity. The existence of angels and activity of angels is something that is a phenomenon in our generation, in our world right now. In fact, everywhere, if you get on YouTube or Google or whatever you want, everyone's trying to capture angels. They're trying to get pictures of angels because there's that hint that angels exist. But I will tell you in this place today that I do believe that angels do exist. But not all angels are angels of light. In fact, there's going to be many angels. And there's going to be many angels that will appear as light, but they will not be light. They will be darkness. And the existence and activity of angels is assumed and hidden in the pages of Scripture. Over 230 times we find them carrying out their work. They were present at every crisis in history. There are two hosts of angels. One, the servant of the Almighty God. And number two, the servant of Satan's angels. First, in the highest order of creation, they were created a host. The Bible says a host of angels, not a race of angels, but a host of angels. I will tell you in this place today that there are angels out there at the bidding of the Lord Jesus Christ. There are angels out there, hear me hell. Hey, there are angels out there that are at the bidding of what God wants. And when God speaks a word, he can send angels out there and can come to your living room and come to your bedroom and come to your workplace, because these angels are at the bidding of God. So when we begin to pray and when we begin to get our minds on the Lord, what happens is this: when God hears our prayers and it's time for our miracle, God can release an angel to come to wherever your situation is. And these angels have authority. These angels have power. These angels, they come with the lightning of the Lord. They come with the anointing of the Master. And when the angels begin to come down, God begins to work and move in miracles. Nothing can stop an angel that's heard from the Lord God Almighty above. Do these angels, they were created by the Creator. He is our Father, but he is their Creator. He is our Father, but he is their Creator. And I want to tell someone's place that we don't worship angels. We don't worship angels. We worship the God that created the angels. Let me tell you, our world right now is fascinated with trying to get a picture of an angel or get a video of an angel. But I'm telling you, we'd be better served to get a picture of Christ and to get a vision of the Lord Jesus Christ. For angels only work under the deity of God. They only work on the severity of God. When you seek God, God. God can send down angels. That's why we need to worship God, because He is the creator of all angels. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise in this place today. Praise God. Angels have some type of spiritual body that can appear to a man. If God wills it, it can happen. We know that only cherubims and seraphims, if you would look at the mercy seat of God, on both sides of the mercy seat, the cherubims and the seraphims, they were arrayed in gold. And when they looked at both sides, wings that were coming down, the deity, the gold, if you would, was the wings, the seraphims. The Bible says have six wings and they can fly swiftly. And in the book of Daniel chapter 9 verse 20 and 21, you can read that they have six wings. This may not necessarily refer to the custom of the angel, but to the quickness of an angel. In other words, is they have six wings, but it's not about the six wings. It's about the time that it takes for them to get to where you are at, for they travel quicker than the speed of light. When God says go, before even the last syllable is mentioned, they've already went and they've already healed and they've already done what they need to do. God has created tens of thousands of angels. We read that in the book of Revelations chapter number 5. The Bible says in Hebrews there's an innumerable company of angels that has come down. Our mind cannot comprehend it. In fact, in this church, it was almost like we could experience the hovering power of angels the last 4 or 5 weeks. What has been going on? This is what's been going on. People been praying. People been fasting. And God's been sending down the angel. The Old Testament looked at it like this. It was the Shekinah glory. It didn't come in six wings. It came as a fog or a smoke in the holy place. What was happening was this, is God's presence. But when God sends an angel, He's sending an angel of healing. He's sending an angel of deliverance. He's sending an angel that can lead to our breakthrough in our life. For when we pray, God hears and He sends down an innumerable amount of angels that come to us. In the Old Testament, an angel ministered to Hagar and Ishmael. When they were cast out, three angels brought God's promises to Abraham and to Sarah. Two angels rescued Lot out of Sodom. An angel called to Abraham to spare Isaac. An angel gave Moses the revelation of God's divine and sovereign name. Angels present at giving of the law. An angel warned Balaam of his disobedience. And an angel destroyed 70,000 Israelites when David disobeyed. An angel strengthened Elijah. An angel slew 185,000 Assyrians. An angel preserved Daniel in the lion's den. And an angel preserved three Hebrew boys that would not stop praying. And there's a fourth one in the fire who looks like the Son of God. I'm telling you, place today, it's time we start expecting the supernatural. It's time we start believing that when God can send an angel, there can be power and deliverance to us today. In the early church, an angel opened up prison doors to release the apostles. An angel sent Philip to the desert to witness. An angel told Cornelius to send for Peter. Note that the angels couldn't preach the gospel. They directed men to the church of the living God. I get weary of people that say, I've had an angelic experience, but you can't get to the house of God. An angel cannot give you the gospel. An angel can only tell you how to get to the gospel. And the angel said, you need to go back to church and you can hear the message preached and that you can hear the sounds of deliverance. What is the gospel? The gospel is the life, the death, and the burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. An angel was only meant to direct people back to God. Their goal was to give people back to God. Angels never accepted worship from man until there was one that sought to be higher than God. But I will tell you this place today that there is no hope for him. He's already been cast down. And his reward is already forever settled in the scriptures. And the Bible said that a third of angels followed him. Can you imagine a third of the angels following him? I wonder what happened to the followers of Lucifer. Perhaps they got caught up because the Bible said that he was the leader of worship. He was the leader of worship. And what happened was this: a third of the angels got caught up in his giftings instead of the Lord's creation. A third of what God had created got caught up in what Lucifer was trying to remake of God. Can I tell you that God is always a creator? We need to follow the creator versus following something or someone that is reproducing what has already been produced. Satan is not a creator. He is the author of confusion, but he is not a creator. For only our God is the one true creator. He's an imitator, but our God is a creator. Why would you want to follow the imitator when you can be saved by the creator? But people had fallen in love. They'd fallen in love with the sound of his music. They'd fallen in love with the beauty of his voice. And unfortunately, when you follow someone's giftings versus following someone's anointing, you will be led down the wrong path. For what good is gifting if their divine gifting leads you to a sinner's hell? I would rather follow the anointing, the creator of God. And I will tell you, this world is not looking for the most talented church. I know some people think that they're not looking for the most talented singers. They're not looking for them. They like talented singers, and it'd be great if you could have talented singers. They're not looking for the preacher who can do, he's a five-tool preacher. No, they're just looking for authenticity. They're looking for someone that's real. They're looking to experience God in a way that they've never experienced God before. And when they come to church, they're not wanting just a boring presentation of an outline of what your plans are. What they're wanting is they're needing healed from drug addiction. They're needing healed in the mind. They're needing healed of fear because they're going to bed every night in fear. But the good news is here today is that same anointing, that same creator that created the heavens and the earth is in this house today. And because he's here, he sends angels of healing. The wisdom of angels has increased over time, and they beheld a dealing of an all-wise God, and the mankind of rest of creation, they're getting wiser. They're understanding. In Psalms chapter 103, we realize that angels are obedient to the Lord's command. That we learn through scriptures, and I'm hurrying up, that angels have strength. Angels are strong. Let me tell you who's not strong. Satan is not strong, because the Bible says when we get over on the other side, that we're going to look at Satan and we're going to say, is this the one that deceived the nations? And other words is that Satan's been talking big talk, but when we finally come face to face with him, we're going to look at him and say, that's it. That's the one. Don't elevate Satan higher than what he really is, because Satan, the Bible said, should be under our feet. If you're looking at him face to face, he's too high. You got to put him under your feet. And we need to understand the power of angels. They're strong. In Revelation chapter 4, verse number 8, we're talking about an angel of holiness. The angels that are full of meekness, angels of joy. Luke chapter 15, verse 10 says, likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God. It did not say that the angels rejoice. It just said that there's joy in the presence of angels. Can I tell you who rejoices? God rejoices when one sinner comes home, and because God rejoices, the angels rejoice. If you want to make God happy, come back home and give your life back over to Jesus again, because the angels rejoice when he rejoices. And so you've got these angels that are everywhere, all around. And Jacob's been battling for 20 years, and the Bible says he encounters a man. He encounters an angel and in Peniel. And Jacob treats this moment in his life like no other moment in history before. Because most of us would have been afraid to wrestle with an angel of God. But when you're so far down, what do you really got to lose? You're already going to bed in fear every night. You're already kind of living and breathing, but you're not really alive. Jacob comes to it. You ever have those moments in life where it's either make me or break me. I don't care no more. You ever have this moment? If you've not had that moment in life, just keep on holding on, because you're going to have that moment in life before it's all over. And maybe perhaps this is preventive, but I'll tell you this place today. And whenever you do have that moment in life, when you come in contact with the Holy Ghost-filled church service, and you come in contact with the Lord God of heaven, and you begin to raise your hands, but this time it feels just a little bit different. I'm telling you today that what you do in the presence of God and angels will make all the difference in the world, whether you get healed or whether you go home the same. But some of us can't go home the same. We gotta wrestle and we gotta fight. What's different about this angel compared to every other angel in history is this, is that Jacob perceives that this is an angel of healing. He perceives, this is my moment. I've never been at this moment for the last 20 years where an angel could come into my life. Hear me out, church, today. Keep our mind on the Lord. There's never been a moment in 20 years in this time where an angel comes in his living room. An angel comes in, and he's broken all protocol, if you would please. He's broken all protocol. Before someone can come into your house, they'll have to take off their shoes. Before they eat at the table, their shoes have got to be off. Their cloth has got to be laid down in a certain direction. And the plate has already been established. The cook has already established. There's certain protocols. And then the angel comes to his place, and Jacob breaks all protocol. He says, you ain't got to take off your sandals. You ain't got to lay down your napkin in a certain place. You ain't got to greet me with a kiss. You don't got to hug me and say, is all your family? He breaks every protocol, because when this angel comes in his house, he doesn't even prepare a meal. He just says, it's time to fight. It's time to roll. It's time to go. And the angel's taken back by it. But Jacob's faith will not let go. For he says, I didn't come to eat. I didn't come to play. I didn't come to pretend. I come to get my miracle. Because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. The difference is, will you fight? All right. I want us all to stand this morning. Man, I wish I had about 15 more minutes. Here's the difference to those that will be healed and those that will not. Is, are you willing to fight for what you want? Because you ain't willing to fight for what you want. God's not into giving you healing because you feel like you've been defeated. Lord, I've been cheated in my whole life, God. Well, you're not ready yet. And I'm telling you something right now. In a microwave generation, we need to learn to let it cook a while. Because everyone who knows anything about cooking knows that nothing great comes through a microwave for 1 minute. Well, praise God. I just offended everyone 25 and younger. Jesus. Here's the truth of the matter, though. God's presence comes in. God's presence comes in. And you can always tell who the hungry folk are. You can always tell who the hungry folk are. Because when God's presence comes in, those that are truly desperate for a miracle don't even wait on an altar call.
Come on, Pastor. Yes, sir.
They don't wait for the music to stop. Right. They don't wait for the pastor to take the microphone and to sing a song. Right. And they don't even wait for that. Because let me tell you why. You tried going to bed in fear for 20 years. Come on. You tried waking up every morning wondering if today's your last day. You try traveling from one tent to the next tent, wondering if God, am I even going to make it here? You see, Jacob didn't know if he was even going to make it to Peniel. So his blessing was already there. But when the angel came in, there's something that clicked with him. There's something that switched in him. It was like a light switch. The light came on and said, wait a minute. This could be my moment to quit fearing what Esau's going to do. And so the only way to fix what Jacob has messed up is if he wrestles and fights with an angel and he says, I will not let you go until you bless me. I will. Oh, if you think that I'm tired, I'm not tired. I'll fight night. I'll fight again. I'll go to the altar again. I'm not done. I'm not going to quit. I'm not finished. I'm going to fight till I get healed. I'm going to war till this thing gets off me.
Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory,
glory. Hallelujah. If you could raise holy hands to Jesus right now, just begin to pray, church. Hallelujah. My God, my God. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Ha la bahaya shoto koya bahaya.
Hallelujah.
Ya soto ko shalom ya bahaya.
Thank you, God.
Come on, why don't you press in a little bit this morning? I know it's just Sunday school. Why don't you press in? Come on now. 20 years is long enough. Come on. It's been a year and you've been going to bed with fear. It's long enough. Hallelujah. 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 God, when is it going to change? It's going to change when you get your fight back. It's going to change when you're not afraid or too tired to get a hold of the prayer altar and say, God, I'm not letting go until this thing falls off me. It's going to dissipate when you finally start participating in what the altar call says you should be doing. God, you're here, and because you are here, I am going to fight for everything that I need in my life. Oh, God. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hear me out, church. Hear me out. Hear me out. We're going to pray again before this is over. What happens when Bethel meets Peniel? Bethel, you heard what I said. Bethel meant the house of God. It was getting out of bed and going to church. That's what it was. It was the house of God. And there's blessings in that. But Peniel meant the face of God. For there'll be a lot of people this morning that woke up and they went to Bethel. But they never saw the face of God when they was at Bethel.
Come on, come on.
Getting up and getting to church doesn't necessarily mean you've all the way got there.
Come on.
Can you hear me out today?
Come on.
Because Bethel truly is not an experience until you meet the face of God while you're there. Pastor, I'm here. Praise God. I'm glad for that. God is blessed. God's going to bless you for that. But while you're here, you might as well see the face of God. And the only way to see the face of God is for us to give him an invitation for him to show up.
How do you do that, Pastor? I'm glad you asked. When we begin to say, Lord, and we begin to praise Him, and we begin to magnify Him, and we begin to offer something up, God says, I inhabit the praises of my people. I'm longing and seeking for those that will worship me. So now that you're in Bethel, we need to give God our attention so He can give us His face. God, we long for you. Fight for it. Fight for it. Fight for it. One more time before we dismiss this service, could you worship the Lord? Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh God, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, come on. Let's get a breakthrough before we transition. Let's get a breakthrough before we transition. Come on, what did you come in this room facing today? Why don't you lift your hands up and begin to magnify God? His face is in this room. Angels are in this room. Wrestle a little bit this morning and praise God. Pastor, I need a miracle. How much are you willing to wrestle for it? Pastor, I need a breakthrough. How much are you willing to fight for it? Oh God, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, my Jesus. Hallelujah, my God, my Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh God, you're worthy, Lord. Oh God. Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. The angel, I know I gotta be done. There's so much meat in this. The angel asked him, you need to read this again. The angel said, what's your name? Like the angel didn't know whose house he was at. Can I tell you why he was asking him? Because he was asking, well, what did Jacob's name mean? Deceiver. What was he asking him to do? He was asking him, hey, I can give you a name change, but you first have to recognize where you're at.
That's it. Come on, preach. Come on.
You need to repent, deceiver, because you never become a prince unless you deny the deity of what you was. I want you to bless me. I want to be a prince. Don't be surprised if God, before God puts a crown on your head, you have to find an altar to bury your head.
That's right. Come on.
And this is the fundamental problem. If you're someone, tell the music to have a meeting without me. This is the problem. We got too many people that don't know who their name is. And yet they're going around talking in tongues, speaking in tongues, running around churches, prophesying all over social media. Here's the problem is this. If God's going to bless you, He's going to bless you a lot of times with a limp. What does the angel do? The angel touches the hollow of his thigh.
Yes, sir.
And it basically makes him walk funky for the rest of his life. We want to walk like Jacob, but have the name of Israel.
Hey, come on, Pastor. Come on. My God. Come on. My God. Come on. Well. Come on. Well. Come on. Breathe, Pastor.
I'm not just stand up. I'm going to be done. Here's the problem is this. You got a lot of Holy Ghost people. You're speaking in tongues like Israel. But your country and your culture doesn't recognize you as Jacob. If you want a name change, you first have to bury what you was in the altar. What's your name? He knew who his name was. But does Jacob know who he was? And Jacob had to answer. He said, my name is Deceiver. Yeah, you're right. And because you've repented, now I can work.
Right.
Because the blessing that I've got for you is more than just a name change. Yeah, right. This name change has a limp attached to it.
Right. Come on, come on. Right.
And you don't want to have a name change with pride in your heart. So God gives you a little something to carry with you every step of the way to remind you that you're not God, He's God. And if you're not careful, you'll have the name of Israel, but walk like an ego-driven maniac like Jacob. And we got too many of those clowns in the church already. What we need to do is go back to wrestling with God and saying, God, I'm glad I'm not who I used to be. And I thank God that your blood saved me and your angel healed me and the Spirit of God delivered me, and I walk differently, I talk differently, I am different because I had an encounter with the God that loved me. And so if we want to keep revival in our church, don't take responsibility for nothing. Because you didn't do any miracles. You didn't do any healings. You didn't give anyone the Holy Ghost. I didn't build this church. I'm not all that in a bag of chips. I'm nothing without the power and the presence of a God that touched us. And don't be surprised if we're blessed, but we still walk with a limp. Don't be surprised if God's moving in our church, but we don't have perfect people. We're just blessed by the power and the hand of God. Don't let my limp fool you. I'm blessed. Hear me out. I mean, next week is our 10th year anniversary, and we're gonna do it up big. Let me tell you something though. When other people may look at our church, they may look at it, well, that's just a bunch of misfits. One of my favorite lines. Well, did you start that church with some of the broken people that came from Greenville? Yeah, we did. Yeah. I always say, yeah, and I stick my chest out like I just got done working out or something. Like, yeah, we did. You know, I don't work out. I don't need to. My wife loves me the same as it is. Yeah, we did. I wear it with the badge of honor. Because let me tell you why. Because you ain't got to be perfect for God to bless you. That's your theory, and that's why God ain't blessing you. I know I'm broken. I know I walk funny. I know we don't have perfect people. I'm not a perfect pastor either. I'll throw that in there. But I'll tell you what we are. We're blessed. We're blessed. There's nothing that we can't do. Why? Because God, from the beginning of time till now, has always worked with broken people. And sometimes God allows for brokenness to come into your life just to remind the devil you shouldn't take him for granted. Because God's always used brokenness to give completeness. And don't be surprised if God takes a bad situation and turns it for your greatest blessing. Because he works in levels of weakness. My weakness, his strength is made perfect. Angels among us. angels among us. My God, we just got to be done. Jesus, Lord, I love you today. God, there's no telling what you're going to do before these doors are closed today. God, I pray that someone in this room today, their faith just jumps out of their seat and says, it's time, it's time, it's time. I pray today, God, that, Lord, we get some violent faith in here, God. Some violent, I won't let go of you until you bless me, faith in this room today. Before these doors are over, God, I open, God, and before they're closed, God, I pray that someone would move in the Spirit, God. I pray that you'd send angels of healing to this church, God. It may be at the beginning of the next service or song service or at the end of preaching. I don't know, God, but I just pray that when you move, God, we move. Because when the angel comes in, Lord, we want to respond. When your presence is here, God, we got to move. We got to move. This could be someone's day, God. I pray, Lord, that faith would jump out of this room. And I pray that someone will be healed in the name of Jesus Christ today, Lord. In the name above all names, someone said, in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Say it again, in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. Shake someone's hand, hug a neck, tell them that you love them today. We'll be back here shortly.